Okay. Today we are going to have discussion about normal move-out correction, and this is one of the primitive correction we carry out or we conduct on seismic data. We'll start about our discussion about normal move-out with a question. This question is, what is normal move-out? The normal move-out is a correction we usually carry to correct offsets greater than zero. So we are looking for having all our traces with zero offset. So to understand what I'm saying, we start by assuming idealized model. I told you before, in science, we usually start with ideal model, and then we move to realized model. Why we start with ideal model? Because ideal models are easy to construct, easy to analyze, and easy to get, and clear to get theory or output from this analysis. So we start our discussion about normal move-out with some assumptions for ideal Earth. These assumptions are, we have a homogeneous layer, and we understand before that homogeneous means we have constant velocity everywhere. The velocity is not changing along the layer. Because if the velocity changes with layer, then at changes we would have all seismic interaction with an interface. We expect to have reflection, refraction, diffraction, and all other interaction at this. Why? Because seismic is sensitive to change in elastic properties of the layer. And this change is reflected on seismic velocity or wave speed. So whenever there is acoustic impedance, difference in acoustic impedance, whenever we have interface and we have reflection, refraction, diffraction, and other types of seismic energy. So we assume that the layer is homogeneous, which means have constant velocity v, and we have flat surface, so we don't have a change in altitude. We have the same altitude, so we do not bother ourselves or worry about this difference or the elevation correction. Also, we assume we have flat layer. This flat layer or flat reflector, also we do not have regular or dipping interface, because if we have regular or dipping interface, so all our assumption here will be not valid. Okay, assuming the layout we are seeing now in the screen, we have the source S and the geophone G with X distance between them. The layer thickness or the depth is D, and the red arrows represent the rays emanating from the source and reflecting and then arriving at the geophone. Generally, to obtain the time taken by someone who goes from place to another one, you usually divide the distance he moves by the velocity or the average velocity he have taken through his course from the starting position to his end position. And this is what we have now in this relation. The time, or better we call travel time, equal R divided by C. Here, R is the overall distance from the source to reflector and then back to the geophone, and C, as we know, is the seismic velocity. R equal 4d squared plus x squared, square root of 4d squared plus x squared. If you're using Pythagoras' theorem, so we have x over 2. We have R equal x over 2 squared plus, sorry, we have R over 2 or half R equal x over 2 squared plus d squared. So multiplying this by 2, we have x squared plus 4d squared under the square root. So R equal 4d squared plus x squared to the power half, divided by C. Of course, in case of normal incidence or zero offset, offset means the distance between the source or the shot point and the hole. If we have zero offset, okay, if we have zero offset, then the time, the travel time reduced to 2d over c, okay, because in this case x will be equal 0, and then the relation goes to 2d over c, and we are going to assign this value as the initial value or origin time value. Okay. Now we are going to simplify the relation by taking the time t0, which is equal to c divided by d, and take this value here as a common value. The relation becomes t equal t0 times square root 1 plus x squared divided by c squared t0 squared. Okay? This relation is a relation of hyperbola. So the difference, the travel time of reflection energy from certain interface takes the form of hyperbola. Okay? Now the term x squared divided by c squared t0 is called the normal move-out term. Our intention in this discussion is to remove the effect or to subtract the effect of this term so that all our time becomes the normal time or the zero offset time, so that in the further analysis we are going to apply stacking. Of course, we apply stacking to enhance signal to noise ratio. Okay, the travel time formula can be further simplified using Taylor expansion. Now we are returning to the basic, the mathematical foundation of our study. Now we are meeting Taylor expansion. We are representing the function with the Taylor expansion. In the present case, we are going to keep only the first term, okay, which is, this is the zero term plus this x squared divided by 2c squared t0, and we are going to ignore the rest of terms. All other terms will be ignored from here. Why we are ignoring the remaining terms? For two reasons. The first one as to simplify the equation. The second one, which is very important, because its magnitude is negligible. So we can neglect this because it lies in the error. It lies in the error limit or acceptable limit for us in our approximation. Before continuing, we have to mention out that the normal move-out correction is applied for CMB gather. What is CMB gather? Anybody know? So one answer. Which means, what's the meaning of common midpoint? What is the mean? I understand CMB is a common midpoint. What is the meaning of common midpoint gather? So we are collecting traces, okay? We are collecting traces for shot geophone pair that reflect from common point in the subsurface or in the reflector, okay? So the common midpoint gather that here in this figure, we have for this interface, we have number of common midpoint. So for certain midpoint of these points, we are collecting number of traces that belongs to shot receiver offsets. Okay? This shot receiver offsets, the midpoint between these two shot receiver offset is this is that point. This is the common midpoint gather. Gather means collecting. We are collecting traces that result from common point in the subsurface. Okay? And what we have here in the right hand side of the figure is how the cross section, the seismic section, looks like for the gathering of common midpoints according to the offsets. So this for certain point at shallower interface, and here another point at deeper, and so on. Also, you realize that the amplitude is decaying with depth, and also you realize also that at shorter offsets, we can determine there is sound spacing. The resolution is visible, but at larger offset, the energy is contaminated or masked with each other. So our intention is to make our data as clear as possible. We are moving further for normal move out for two reflectors. We are here trying to get the so-called the general relation. We can define the normal move-out for single reflector, but here we are trying to get general relation for more than one reflector. In this case, we have two reflectors, two flat horizontal reflectors. The first one with velocity C1, this or alpha. Sorry, alpha and beta are the angles, C1 and C2. The thicknesses of the interface of the layers are D1 and D2. The offset between the source and the receiver is X, and then the offset at the interface is X2. What we have here, or what we know, is two factors or two parameters. The first one Can one answer me, what is the first non-parameter for us?
The distance.
The distance, what distance?
X.
The distance x, okay. Excellent. The distance x between R, between the geophone and the shot. What is the second known parameter we have? What is the second known parameter we have? No, we are looking for velocity. We are looking for velocity. We don't have velocity. Okay? Time. Okay. So we have two known information here, the x, the distance between, the surface distance between the source and the receiver, and the travel time from the source to the second interface and then back to the receiver. The unknown here are numerous, and we are going to analyze this. This interface, we have this one is at depth 300, the second reflector, and we have the velocity of the first layer of 1,500 meters per second, and the velocity of the velocity of the first layer at 1,500 meters per second, while the velocity at the second layer is 2,500 meter per second. What we have in the diagram to the right hand side is the actual, the solid line is the actual or the synthetic travel time obtained. The dashed line represents the hyperbolic fitting to this line. Now, we have to take into consideration one important issue is that in seismic processing, we are not interested in the extra time delay due to the receiver position offset, but we have the image of the subsurface should be independent of it. The seismic section you see is not dependent on the offset between the source and receiver. And this is called zero offset image of the seismic cross section. So our intention, or we are needing, or we are asked to remove the extra time delay due to the normal move out. So it is a must for us to remove the normal move out and to have the zero offset traces, or the corrected zero offset traces. Then we are assuming the two interfaces in the previous figure, the travel time relation becomes like the one we discussed earlier, but here we are generalizing our relation to two layer or more than one interface or one more than one reflector. Here we have x minus x2 square plus 2d 1 square, all under the square root sign, divided by the velocity of the first layer, plus x2 square plus 4d2 square under the square root sign, divided by the velocity of the second layer. Now if we return, we have, where is x1? X1 is this part and this part. These two parts are called x1 in our case. And of course, x2 is here. Then, taking 2d divided by c1 as a common term, then the relation for the first term, the representation of first term become 1 plus x minus x2 squared divided by 4d1 squared, all under the square root, plus likewise 2d2 divided by c2 square root 1 plus x2 squared divided by 4d squared. Okay, we can obtain directly by taking the common term here. And then this one we defined earlier in the previous discussion as the t1 or t0 and t2. This is the zero offset time for the first layer, and this is the zero offset time for the second layer. And the relation here become t1 square root 1 plus x1 squared divided by t1 squared c1 squared plus t2 square root 1 plus x2 squared divided by t2 squared c2 squared. As we said, t1 and t2 represent the zero offset travel time through the first and second layer. Here we have x1 equal x minus x2. So in order to know x1, we need to get an idea about x2. The problem is that we don't have x2. So how to solve this problem? So our problem here is to determine the value of x2. Generally speaking, in analysis and derivation, there is a lot of approximation, a lot of assumption to arrive to certain result, and then we compare the result with the original or with the observation to see if our assumption and our approximation are in agreement with the ideal, with the real case. So we expect to have small difference between the approximate analysis or approximate derivation and the observation. If our assumption is invalid, so we will have a big difference, and so our analysis is not valid. Here, our approximation, of course, because it's tested, it's valid. We are going to approximate travel time here also with the Taylor expansion. You see, we are facing Taylor expansion many times, and also Fourier expansion, Fourier series, and Fourier transform also many times. That's why we studied this in the first place at the starting of this course. So we do the same. We represent or we approximate the function with the Taylor expansion series. We end up with t1 plus x1 squared divided by 2t1 c1 squared plus 2 t subscript 2 plus x2 squared divided by 2 squares. Then we square both sides. So the right hand side becomes t squared, and the right hand side becomes squared plus order of x to the power 4. This order to the order of x to the power 4 represent the error. Okay, so this is the order of error we expect to have. So if x is less than 1, so x to the power 4 is great or is small? It's small. Why? Because the raising the raising fractions to higher powers result in smaller value approaching to zero. So in this case, but of course, and this we are going to speak about it at the end of this lecture, when x is large, so x to the power 4 becomes very high value and thus result in big error in our estimation. Even after squaring, even after applying Taylor series and squaring, we still have x2 and we didn't solve the problem yet. How we are going to solve this? We are going to use Snell law. What we have now is a Snell law. You know Snell law?
Yes.
It's one of the pillars of seismic and optics also. Snell law states that the sine of the incident angle divided by the velocity of the first layer equal the sine of the refracted angle divided by the velocity of the second layer. In our case, we have refraction. Right or wrong? We have refraction at the intermediate interface. So we are going to apply Snell law. From trigonometry, we have at small angles, sine alpha equals or approaches tan alpha. So we can substitute sine alpha with tan alpha, which means we have, according to Snell law, we have x1 divided by 2d1 times c1 equal or approaching x2 divided by 2d2c2. Okay, now we are beginning to solve our problem. Or in other words, x1 divided by t1 c1 squared equal x2 divided by t2 c2 squared. Substituting in the relation, we have x2 equal t2 divided by t2 times c2 squared divided by t1 c1 squared x1. We are going to substitute for x2 in the relation x1 plus x2 equal x. Then we have the value of x1. Okay, now we have the value of x1, which equals x t1 c1 squared divided by t1 c1 squared plus t2 c2 squared. Likewise, we solve for x2 to obtain similar relation with the change of the indices. Now we have information, we have got the information for x1 and x2. So our problem is solved, and the travel time of the following form can be used. So in the travel time, we are going to replace each term with x1 and x2 with its equivalent representation. In this case, t squared, which is the total travel time, equal t1 plus t2 squared plus t1 plus t2 times x squared times t1 c1 squared plus t2 c2 squared divided by t1 c1 squared plus t2 c2 squared all squared. Of course, here we can subdivide the numerator with one of the two parts or the square of one of the squares of the denominator. We end up with the relation that T1 plus T2 square equal T1 plus T2 divided by T1 C square, C1 square plus T2 C2 square times X square.
What is
cause?
Is it necessary for us to know how to prove?
If I said yes,
I just want to.
So, no. It's you're right. If I said yes, it would be so difficult for you. No. Okay, you are exempted from proofing. Okay, but at least if you have problem, you should have. The final form and the parameter you enter to solve the problem. So in case you have problem, you need at least to know the final law. So proofing is not you are exempted from proofing. Now we can rewrite the last equation in the form. The square of travel time equal t total of 0 square, which means t1 plus t2, or the 0 offset for the first interface plus the 0 offset of the second interface, plus x square divided by c square rms, where c square rms is called the root mean square velocity. The root mean squared velocity is divided by this relation. It equals 1 divided by t total. Summation from I equal 1 to n, ci squared ti null. In our forthcoming analysis of velocity, we're going to use many types of velocity, and so root mean squared is one of this velocity we have. I don't know whether you know the average velocity, the interval velocity. We have many types of velocities that we are going to tackle in our study. Here, ti of 0 denotes the 0 offset travel times through the ice layer, and t total of 0 denotes the total 0 offset time, which means the summation of all the zero offset time. Now we have important notice. The normal move-out correction now is estimated. We must keep in mind that this correction is restricted to our assumptions. This assumption is constant velocity, flat horizontal reflector, and small to intermediate offsets. Okay, I guess we understand why small to intermediate offset, because of the term order, which is the remainder term, which is order of x to the power 4. Okay, as if x is large, the order of error or misfit will become also large. So, in our case, as long as we have nearly constant velocity, and we have also nearly flat horizontal reflector, because generally speaking, we have no homogeneous layer, no homogeneous medium, even the atmosphere is not homogeneous. So in the Earth there is no homogeneity, we have heterogeneity. So to a certain extent, depending on the Fresnel zone, which means depending on the frequency content of our data, we can approximate the layer or the interface of the Earth as homogeneous to a certain extent. If this extent is not valid, so we have a problem applying the normal move-out correction. So to apply normal move-out correction, we have three main steps. First, we determine root mean squared velocity. Second, we determine the normal move-out delay factor for certain offset. Okay, we return back to the relation, the final relation. Here, we have, in this relation, we have the x squared, which is the offset. We have root mean squared velocity. So in order to apply the root mean squared, we have to get x squared, and we have to have representation of c, or the root mean squared velocity, according to x. And finally, we remove the normal move out factor to shift the time of the trace back to zero offset. So our intention is to make the hyperbola feature of the CMB gather into, to move it into flat line, flat line at the time of the zero offset. In this case, we have the energy of the reflectors, of the reflector in coherent, in phase, we say coherent, so that in the step of stacking, the energy in this case will be summed up. We'll have here constructive interference. What about noise? Noise have different velocity. So when we apply the delay, they will be either out of phase or at least not in phase. So their amplitude are either vanish or keep the same. Thus, if I'm having, say, 48 trace, so the data, the amplitude of the reflector is enlarged by approximately 48 times, while the amplitude of the noise is kept the same. So I am making high signal to noise ratio. The diagram here, or the figure here, show the situation. Here is a zero offset, which is or near zero offset at zero, where the geophone and the source coincide. And here is the offset increasing. And this is the result we would like to see. The final one is the Fourier transform of the amplitude spectrum of our traces. However, the world is not all the way beautiful and good. Inside good time we must have bad time. So we have here big problem with the normal move out called stretching. If you carefully look at this diagram, you will see that here is the wavelet representing the reflection at the zero offset. With the offset, you realize that it's stretching. You see, increased, the time increased. And it's evident here also at the amplitude spectrum. So we are affecting the frequency content of the data, which make the waveform in this shape. So if I'm using the data without taking care or solving the problem of stretching, I'm ending up with a big problem also. Because after certain traces, after some traces, you will find that when I sum up the energy, part of the energy will be removed because of the phase difference between the waveform of the traces with offsets. Okay? Stretching occurs because NMO is not dependent on X and CRMS only. However, it depends also on the zero offset time T0. When T becomes larger, the NMO becomes smaller and the stretching took place. This idea is illustrated in the following figure. As you see, here T 0.1 and here T 0.2. As T increased, you see here is the delta NMO, this is a correction term, is small at certain offset compared to smaller zero offset time of the first interface. This change, this dependence, result in stretching of the time series or the time axis of the trace. The stretching can be measured by the quantity delta T NMO. Delta T NMO is the normal move-out correction. This is a term that we subtract from each successive offset to return to the zero offset time, divided by T0, which is the zero offset time. This quantity is related with frequency distortion via the relation delta TNMO divided by T0 equal delta F divided by dominant frequency, where F dom is the dominant frequency. So, how we are going to solve this problem? This problem is solved by removing or muting, you know, the word mute, when you're watching TV and somebody's talking to you and you are distracted, you want to listen to him, you mute, which means you cut the sound of the TV or radio or PC to understand what is saying, and then you may return. So mute means to cut the energy, or to cut the energy after certain distortion we have. Here we have an example. This is the case with two interface. Here we have distortion, stretching without muting, and here we are applying muting. Sometimes we apply muting for delta F divided by F domination equal to 100%, or delta NMO divided by T0 equal 100%. So we are going to mute, not to lose what we are looking for. We are looking for what is our objective here. Why we are conducting seismic data processing? Signal to noise ratio enhancement. Okay? Like, you know your name? You know your name?
Yes.
What's your name?
Nadia.
So you must keep and save this like your name to enhance signal to noise ratio. So if we didn't take care of the stretching, so we lose the benefit of what we are doing, we lose the objective we are looking for. Okay? This is a reference of the present lecture. Thank you and see you tomorrow, inshallah.